So we're you're here because presumably you're interested in the topic of why players leave games. And just a little bit of housekeeping. This is my Twitter account, Nelson Rodriguez. This is Akamai's. Feel free to comment here, put photos up, take a photo of yourself giving a thumbs up and send it to these accounts. Also, if there's anything that I talk about that you want to talk about more in depth, we have a table 702, which is when you go out this door, it's straight in the back corner. All these doors have been locked, so you cannot escape. So that's one way to gain retention. This is the main kind of driver of this topic for me. This is the reason why this topic is interesting to me is I've looked at a bunch of different stats, and there are a couple different stories on this, but the general consensus is that within the first 30 days, 95% of players will leave a game. I read something yesterday from Game Analytics that indicated that in China, this number might actually be 100%, that retention is close to zero at day 30. So, I mean, we can debate what it is, but if it's, you know, if this is really 90% of players leaving, it's still a significant number. And I think that what happens is when you hear that kind of number, some of us get hopeless about it. We say, well, that number's so high, what could we possibly do about it? But I think in that number, there's a lot of potential for improvement. So the question that got me to talk about this topic is why are all of these players leaving? And of course, I think there's a very simple answer. There's not enough screaming in your icon is the reason they're leaving, right? So this was, you've probably seen this, several journalists have talked about how consistent some of the design styles are for icons on the App Store, particularly for the strategy category. These are top grossing strategy apps made by different companies, most of these. And they use the same aesthetic style. So I use this example to make the point that aesthetics is not what I'm gonna talk about. Because to me, aesthetics it could absolutely be relevant for your game, and it could be relevant for your audience and how they feel about your game, but it's not a scalable problem to solve. You know, we can't just say if everything was hand-drawn or if everything was 8-bit that it would solve the retention problem across multiple games. So to me, I really don't wanna talk about aesthetics. So what I actually did, over the past year, I've been obsessed with this topic. So I work for Akamai, and Akamai's main focus is trying to reduce points of friction across the entire player experience, from the delivery of the game to login to security. But that business gives me an opportunity to travel the world and talk to developers and publishers all over, and that's what I've done for the last year. And so I've had developer survey, customer interviews. We also fielded a couple studies of real players and asked them very specifically, what are the reasons that you leave a game? And we also, we drank a lot of rum in the process. That actually means real user metrics. So we look at the data from our own network. We push a very large percentage of the internet's traffic, so we get to see a lot of behaviors, including when players abandon a download, when players abandon a login, that whole experience for players, we get to see a lot of it. So what's come up consistently in what players tell us, in what developers tell us that they see from feedback and from the behavior in their own games, is that players typically are leaving for friction. Now again, friction is not the only reason, but to me, friction is the reason that is scalable, that every single person in this room is dealing with. There may be people in this room for whom having more unicorns may help your game, or the sounds that the game makes, or particular gameplay loops could be really important for you. But in addition to those very specific things, I think that there are general points of friction. Players in the survey, their responses were pretty wide-ranging. They said things like, I leave the game because it wasn't difficult enough after a certain time. I leave the game because my friends quit. I leave because the paywall was too oppressive. But some of the data that came up that was really interesting to me was there are a lot of people who said they leave a game because it takes too long to load, which feels in some ways like such a small detail. But 40% of players said that they leave because the game takes too long to load. And we tried to dig in to see, is this a hardware issue? Is this specific to the network? And for players, there were a lot of different reasons that load times were painful. Another interesting stat was that a quarter of players said that they left a game because it updated too frequently. Another quarter of players said that they left a game because it didn't update enough. So when we talk about that stat, a lot of people throw up their hands and they say, well, if updating too much is a problem and not enough is a problem, then we can't make players happy. But to me, that's a perfect example of a stat that you can study a little bit further and say, you know, our speculation on this based on what we've seen is players want you to fix the game. They want you to fix bugs. They want you to update the game with fresh content. But they don't want to, when they're sitting on the MRT, they don't want to have to wait for the update. So they want what the fixes give them. They just don't necessarily want the friction that happens. Now, when I had this conversation a couple weeks ago in another city, this question came up of why friction, you know, why do you think friction is so important compared to other factors? To me, friction, this is a crazy statement I'm gonna make, so hopefully you can use Twitter to challenge me on this, but to me, friction is the single biggest topic of the last 10 years in our industry. And specifically, I mean, the management of friction is, I think, the key innovation in our industry. I've been in the games business for about 10 years. I started at Xbox, and I've worked with publishers big and small. It's been a big space for me. And as much as we talk about style and aesthetics, friction, I think, is the driver. And I'm going to explain what I mean. Over the last 10 years, these are the three concepts to me that have driven growth in our business. Casual, of course, the name of the conference is Casual Connect. Casual, the casual space and the idea of creating games that can appeal to a casual audience is something that over the last 10 years has driven a tremendous amount of growth. When I was at Xbox, they were desperately trying to appeal to a casual audience. They, I think, struggled to do that, and all the consoles have really struggled to do that after the Wii. But that moment of the Wii, and in many ways the mobile space as well, has been about casual players, getting more players engaged. Mobile, I would argue, is the second really large change over the last 10 years in our space. Right? Mobile now represents 37% of the total market in terms of revenue, despite the fact that 10 years ago it was tiny. And it's eating up share from PC and console. So I think mobile, I think everybody would agree that mobile is a major trend within our industry. I'm actually curious, how many people here are working on games that are either mobile or casual? A fairly large number, right? Which means you're at the right conference, which is good. Free to play, I would say, is the third major trend over the last 10 years. If you look at revenues on the App Store, iOS App Store as an example, the overwhelming majority of revenue from games comes from free to play games. Now, whatever you think about paywalls, the fact is free-to-play is a significant driver in our business. To me, if you look at these three trends, these trends are not about character types. These trends are not about art style. These trends are not even about specific gameplay mechanics. To me, these are about friction. First of all, casual games is all about the reduction of difficulty friction, just this idea that some players will be so put off by difficulty that you design the game to allow them in more easily. That's all about, it's reduction of friction no matter what genre you decided to release a casual game in, whether it's a puzzle, whether it's a quest type game, whether it's a hidden object game. Reducing difficulty friction, at least at the very beginning, is a key reason why this part of the industry has grown. Mobile, for me, is all about the elimination of place friction. You can play anywhere. You don't have to wait until your sister is done with the TV. You don't have to wait until you get home to your PC. For many people, they don't even have to wait until they're out of the bathroom. They can play a game at any time, right? That place friction is, to me, more important than whether it was a match three game or it had gems or if it was 8-bit style. It's about the fact that you eliminated a point of friction that could easily make players not play. Right now, you know, when we leave this talk, which you can't leave until I say, you can't play a game, right? Like, as soon as you come out of here, you couldn't play your PC game, you couldn't play your console game, but you can play a game on your phone. And free-to-play is all about the delay, or in some ways, I would say, the hiding of payment friction. So as a marketer, which is most of what I've done in the industry, payment friction is a huge topic, right? How do you get someone to go to a store and pay money? How do you get someone at the very beginning to pay their money? Free-to-play was us innovating that, right, as an industry, saying, you don't have to pay now, you can pay in a day, you can pay in 10 days. And if we're good at it, we hide the friction so that it feels like a natural extension of the game, like okay, you know, it's Hearthstone, right? I've played this for 30 days already, and I don't mind paying money for a pack, or I don't mind paying money to unlock a quest that's going to give me new cards. It's all about friction. So these are two questions that I think you need to ask yourself as you look at your own games. And I think part of what I really want you to think about is, how do you look at, if you look at that whole list that I gave you, if you look at the list of all of the reasons that people leave, how do you figure out a way to prioritize that? Because you could say, okay, yeah, I know that I have these 12 points of friction, but what do I do about it? And that's actually what a lot of people say. That's what a lot of folks say when I talk to them. They say, well, you know, my tech team has other priorities, or the business guys have different priorities. To me, I think you can start, and this could take you an hour, conceivably. We could, after this, we could sit down and run this test for 20 minutes on a specific game and ask these two questions. How harmful is the friction, and how avoidable is it? Now, Pete, you may think, like, well, isn't all friction harmful? I think, actually, no. You may find that there are some points of friction that are necessary or even beneficial, and some of them are, of course, not avoidable. And I think if you can answer these questions, you can create a kind of matrix, right? A very simple matrix to help you categorize your friction and prioritize it. So first, beneficial friction that's avoidable, I think difficulty would be a good example. So we talked about casual games, but it may be that for your game specifically, for the kind of audience that you're targeting, you want a certain amount of difficulty. That's going to make the game really interesting. It's a point of friction, right? No question that my mom or my best friend might actually say, God, you know, this game that you love, Nelson, is just so difficult. I don't like playing it, but maybe I love it. And maybe that, you know, 200,000 or 4 million person audience for your game is exactly the kind of audience that wants this point of friction. And so for this, maybe you live with it, and I'll talk about what you can do with this kind of friction, but that's an example of it, right? Another form of beneficial friction that you cannot avoid is extracting money, extracting value of some kind. It doesn't have to be paywall, it could be advertising, but you know, we can't have this conference and you can't have your business if you don't somehow extract value. So that's a point of friction that actually is helpful for your business and that you probably cannot avoid. And I don't, if anybody figures out a way to make a living in this business without extracting value from players, I'd love to hear about it. Now this bottom right corner is sort of, I would call this the depressing corner that I wouldn't even worry a lot about. There may be unavoidable friction that's not great. It doesn't help your player, it doesn't help you, but it's a requirement of the particular country that you're releasing a game into. Maybe it's a limitation of the hardware that you're releasing on that you want access to that customer base, but there's just nothing you can do about the fact that maybe it's slow, maybe it's limited, maybe there's limitations in performance that you can't do anything about. This last corner, this bottom left corner, for me is my obsession. This is what I call the stupid corner. Everybody can go sit in the stupid corner if you get stuck with this, right? These are avoidable points of friction that are not helpful to the player. They don't make you more money. They don't help your brand. Nothing good comes from this corner. Bad UX is a great example. I was at DICE in Vegas a couple months ago, and I was talking to a developer and publisher of a PC game that is a spaceship game. And you can equip your ships, you can build out a whole fleet. And they talked about the UX challenges that they were facing, which is when a player jumps into the game, they have to make dozens of choices about what kind of ship they want to have, what class of ship, what kind of drive system, what kind of weapon system. And it was putting off a lot of players. There was someone else in this roundtable discussion who actually chimed in and said, well, it's interesting that you're dealing with this, because we had a game that had a play button at the very start that we removed and ended up getting 10% more players on the first day. Literally because of a play button, which sounds crazy to me, but that one choice where the game starts up and then you say, well, do I play, do I not play? Literally 10% of people actually said, yeah, maybe after I've launched this, I don't want to play anymore. So by changing that one choice, they ended up with a better performance, better experience for the player. So bad UX, with a play button being just one example and a complicated menu being another, is a case where it doesn't have to be there. And that's a decision that you can help increase the performance, the overall experience for players, and is fixable. for us, this sort of space that we're in, slow loads, slow downloads, slow logins, servers being down because they were attacked. That's another area where you could say, you know, theoretically, you could say, well, I don't know if I've got the time or the money to solve, but it's not helping anybody. It's not making you money to leave that problem there. To me, that's something worth fixing. So these are examples of friction, and I wanted to talk about what you could do in each of these areas of the, or each quadrant of this matrix. So for beneficial friction that you can, that can be avoided, a really good idea is to balance it. To say, okay, you know, I want it in, and you've got to basically determine the players that I'm losing, is it worth it? You know, is it worth the benefit? So that, to me, I kind of think of that as like friction versus enjoyment, or friction versus fun, right? Like if the game is going to be made more fun because you introduce this friction, then you have to make this determination, and you can look at, you can look at it from a statistics point of view to say, okay, when we made it a little bit harder, did we get longer retention for the players who stayed, and could we afford the players that dropped off because of it? That's a kind of a simple calculation that you can make, right? Did we end up with a higher lifetime value? Did we end up with higher retention for the paying players? And did we lose maybe an acceptable amount of players in the process? For beneficial friction that you cannot avoid, I think hiding or delaying is a great model. I think payment is something where we've done this really well for games that succeed. You put that point of friction in such a context and in such a way that the player doesn't really notice, and they're not necessarily put off by it. This is maybe like a Buddhist answer here. You know, come to some acceptance on the friction that you can't do anything about, although theoretically there may be some harmful friction, hardware-based friction, or you know, restrictions of partnership where you've got to put logo screens up, where you can make it more interesting, you can make it fun, you can hide the loading screens, that's possible. And then for harmful friction that you can avoid, you have to eliminate it. If you don't eliminate it, you're hurting your business for not a great reason. Now, I mean, of course, we have to be realistic. Maybe your team is 8 people, and everybody's working 60 hours a week or 80 hours a week, and so you can't get to every problem. But if you could sit down for an hour and rank the complaints that you hear from players, rank the concerns that your team has, and put them in these buckets, you may be able to actually say, oh, you know, we were trying to solve this problem that isn't as important, and here's another one that is, and you can start, at the very least, applying metrics to it, applying some sort of measurement to it. So the question you need to ask yourself as you get out of here is, where is your friction, right? Where is it in your game, and where can it be fixed? As I said at the very beginning, we could sit down and have discussions, as sort of common soul discussions about, is your art style something beautiful? Is it something that people are going to fall in love with? Are the player hooks really deep and interesting? But I think that kind of conversation is something that you're going to have in small pockets, because your genres are different, the audiences are different. But the friction discussion is something you can have with everyone. And I've found that people are really willing and eager to have these really honest conversations to say, you know, oh, here's my problem with the play button. Here's the problem with too many options that we gave players. Here's what we did to hide the load screen. Here's what one company who publishes some very, very popular, well-known sort of puzzly games based on action games on console. They published these to mobile. They started thinking about, what if we gave players a previously on experience, so that after they've been out of the game for 7 days, when they pop back in, we can remind them very quickly of where they were, and because progress, right? Like losing track of your progress was one great point of friction that players were experiencing. They thought about solving it in that way. So I think I would love to have this discussion with anyone who'd be interested in having it, and I would be curious if there's anyone brave enough to say, anyone who agrees with this, disagrees with it, any thoughts at all, I would love your I'd love your feedback.
Well, I'll tell you my problems with all the games, since basically I do mobile game publishing, and then most of our games right now are coming from Japan, and then with their heavy assets, and we are a client of Akamai, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
And loading
up.
Very good. Downloading speed increased by 60%, and then retain more user. Exactly.
Wow. I'm going to give you some cheesecake when you get out of here.
Right. So that's the main problem that we see. And I do agree with you in certain things in terms of updating the, like, we do, like, new characters and in, like, weekly basis. And then we also see, I mean, we try it out, and then we also see that, hey, you know what? We might want to give more values to these characters so that users are still talking about them after just 1 week, and a new one comes out, and then, you know, you kill it too fast.
Yeah.
Right? But some certain stuff, like stages and all that, you might want to keep on going, look at your players like closely. If they finish it, if 20% of your players finish all the levels, then you might be thinking already of releasing a new one as soon as possible
right.
to keep those players going. So what you said here, I think, is pretty cool.
Yeah. Well, so I'm curious about your experience. How often are you updating? Is it weekly?
Depending on the games.
Yeah.
So on one of the game, we do it 2 weeks for new characters. The new ones, we're doing a week, and then we're seeing the different. So we're kind of like expanding that out as well.
And how do you manage the update in terms of the App Store versus side loading? Which do you use?
We do side loading
for all your updates.
Yes.
Other than major client.
Except for major client changes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Interesting. Yeah. So I've talked to a lot of companies that do sometimes they'll use an alternating model. They'll use the App Store when they want to, for whatever reason, make it really obvious to players that there's a new update. Mm. And then they'll use sideloading when they don't want it to be painful or obvious, right? Where they want to be able to update or if they want to update the content to a specific calendar. Like, you know, when it's certain TV shows coming out or movies coming out, they want to be able to control the timing. They'll use the sideload as opposed to the App Store. But it sounds like you're using sideloads most of the time.
When you were doing the research on friction and why players leave, did you run across any examples of social friction that caused players to leave?
Yeah, so it was interesting. One of the big answers was that my friend left, which is, it's interesting when you talk about social friction. When I was working with the Xbox Live team, we spent years, anybody who plays on Xbox Live will find this funny, we spent years wondering how we could get people to be less mean on Xbox Live. Or like how we could gate it or make it so that certain players didn't have to experience the really painful, you know, trolls. That was never really solved. But the answer that we got back of my friends leaving to me felt like a secondary answer, right? Because your friends left for some reason. So then, you know, you leaving because your friends left means that it's a ripple effect from some other reason. Before you left, your friend did. But that was really... I forget what the percentage was. It was like 35 or something percent of people said that they left because their friends were no longer playing, which is for multiplayer games, right? That's always a real key question. How do you keep players invested in helping their fellow player, right? Like, I think it's an important topic. I think it's a little bit harder to dig into because it's going to be very different per genre. That's going to be, I think, very different for specific to the game mechanics and even the monetization model. What do you let people invest in and buy, and how does that affect the social? So I actually know a guy who I work with whose team spent on average $60,000 a month on assets or upgrades for it was a multiplayer, a competitive game, and it was a team of like 15 people, and they were spending over $5,000 a piece. And this was because of the social component, right? Because they felt a commitment to each other. This was like a dedication to make sure that the team stayed competitive.
I really hope they did well.
I think they were like second ranked. So I don't know. I guess that's good enough. But for 60,000, that seems high. Thanks for your question. I think are we out of time? I believe.
We're okay. We're okay with time. We can stop here. And if you have further questions, you can...
Perfect.
You can contact.
Great. Thank you very much.
On the show. Thank you very much.